The stage is set. The bright lights are on. Welcome along to Obviously Fight Talk episode 61. And I am joined, as always, by hashtag one job, Mr. Win Decision, Mr. Robert Palin.
How's it going, man?
Not too bad, buddy.
Buddy?
Yeah, hey, buddy.
How was Belfast? Derry? Was Derry.
Derry this weekend was Derry. It's a long, forget Tipperary, it's a long, long way to Derry.
Yeah.
Some good fights, and holy moly did they pack out that hall.
Yeah,
Absolutely jammed. A K1 and kickboxing, good fights. Long journey, long round trip. Tired on Sunday. So while we're here, if you're watching on YouTube, subscribe by clicking and subscribe. Hit the subscribe button below so you don't miss any future videos. Don't forget to like and share this video with your friends on Facebook, Twitter, or any other social media you use. Word of mouth will help us grow. Also comment in the comment section, Rob will answer because he's the answerer. To your comments. Big shout out as always to Fight Star Ireland, the fighter's choice. Everything you need under one roof, from groin guards to the best of gear, the best of gloves, anything you need, check them out. They're amazing.
Those t-shirts as well.
Yep, and they're good people. And MMA. They're all right. MMAMix.com for all your MMA needs. They're obviously good. Because there would obviously Fight Talk. 61, and boy, do we have a good show for you this week. We will have your quickfire news, as always, 15 minutes quickfire news. We're going to have 3 minutes on the clock this week, just me and Rob, but we're going to burn the ears off you for 3 minutes on each subject. Basically, we will read out a subject, and we have 3 minutes to talk about it. We'll also be joined as well. The new piece that everybody seems to love at the moment is just getting on with Johnny Jitsu. We'll be trying a subject that Johnny will... Let go and do what Johnny does. Yeah. Delighted to stay. We are joined by one of the best worst nicknames in MMA.
Yeah. Self-proclaimed.
Yeah. He went viral with a call out of Dillon Danis this weekend after a stunning performance. I think we should be talking more about the stunning performance than the call out.
Speak about that, definitely.
Such is life. Yeah, 100%. So we have Steve Thunder Beast.
I love it.
Kozola joining us, the Bellator lightweight. We have your weekend roundup. We'll be talking Cage Warriors 82 and Bellator 175 went down at the weekend. We will then be joined, Rob, by a featherweight champion.
Yeah.
From EFC, a young Scottish man from Edinburgh called Danny Henry. Danny will be joining us just to speak about Danny's hungry and he wants on UFC Scotland.
Yeah, so I've heard, and it's been stirring up on social media, so we'll speak to him about that and see if he has made any progress in getting onto the
And
card.
Again, he is the reigning defending EFC featherweight champion. Check him out. All his fights are up on Facebook as well, EFC. I'm looking forward to talking to Danny and getting to know him that little bit.
Yeah.
As we do and see how the push for the UFC is going. We'll also have your UFC 210. It's fight week. It's been a while since the big show rolled into town. We have had your Bellator's Cage Warriors. UFC is back in our lives on Saturday night, and it's UFC 210. And we will be joined by Darren Russell. Darren Russell is a writer with MMA Latest and the Odds Bible. So I'm looking forward as well talking to Darren.
Yeah, it's going to help us break down the UFC 210 card. Maybe give us a couple of tips.
Because
I am broke.
Yeah,
some money.
Yeah, a few tips. So follow him obviously on the Odds Bible as well if you're looking for good tips.
Before we move on to quickfire news, I think you forgot something.
What did I forget?
WrestleMania.
Wrestle.
Where's the WrestleMania recap? Speaking of the big show must have been wrestling last night. No.
Well, I put up a Facebook post going, I'm going to be wrecked tomorrow staying up for WrestleMania. And then I was like, oh, no, wait, hold on, it's fake. I guess it's an early night. No, this is a fight podcast, not a theatrics
Brock Lesnar
podcast.
Apparently, won.
Fuck Brock Lesnar. The Undertaker retired as well. Spoiler alert,
Jesus.
The Undertaker left his fake hat and his fake cloak in the ring, apparently.
I believe the clothes are real.
For somebody who doesn't know anything, I seem to be knowing a lot.
Yeah.
The Hardy Boys made a return as well.
Fuck off.
It was all on Facebook. Get a fucking life.
Oh, I'm so tired.
Yeah, fucking losers. If you're into wrestling, you know, I don't know, Narnia, closet. So here we go, quick fire news. Rob, get your clock ready.
Yeah.
I said clock. This is 3 minutes on the clock. We're going to talk, we're going to mention a subject, and we got 3 minutes to talk about it. When that 3 minutes is up,
We're up.
Subject is over. So TJ Dillashaw grudge match, Dominic Cruz rematch. If UFC bantamweight champion Cody Garbrandt has his way, it will be neither. In an interview last week, Garbrandt said that his goal is to be the UFC's first three-division UFC champion. And the first step would be to go down to 125 and challenge Mighty Mouse Demetrius Johnson. What do we think of Garbrandt moving to flyweight to challenge for the title?
Don't really like it. Not that I don't like the fight. I do like the fight because it's a really, really good fight. It'd be interesting to see how Demetrius can handle somebody of that size. There is a lot of guys at flyweight who could probably compete at bantamweight, and we've seen some guys going up like John Lineker. Now, we didn't get to see that fight, but I think it's too early to make that fight. You just win the title. I think you have to defend it a couple of times. We always say it, that Conor McGregor is the exception. For bad or for bad or for good, he is the exception because he makes the money fights. Garbrandt versus Mighty Mouse even a super fight? I'm not sure. It's a super fight. I definitely say it's a super fight, but is it a money fight? I'm not too sure about that. So I find that kind of a bit weird. I thought it would make more sense for him to go up. That would be more of a super fight, more of a money fight. But I do like the fight, but I don't think it should happen. Not right now, anyway.
I can feel a rant coming on. I can even hear it in me sighing as you're talking.
Yeah.
Defend the belt.
Yeah.
There's so much at bantam. There's no need.
There's two built-in fights there.
Yeah,
there's
no built-in fights. There is no need.
Yeah.
To be going down or to go up. Why is it when every champion all of a sudden is winning the belt, they want to move division?
It's that era. It's defend the era of the money
your
fight.
Belt. Yeah. Like, it's Demetrius Johnson is worthy of moving up a weight class.
Yeah, because he's beat
everybody,
including your mother.
Exactly. I'm mad. Take him. But defend your belt, Garbrandt. You know what I mean? You've only won it. Yes, you won it in amazing fashion over Dominic Cruz. But that rematch, Dominic Cruz is worthy of a rematch. TJ Dillashaw, they're on tough with them at the moment. Another, that's an unbelievable match. But there's so many good fights at 135. Why? Is it like, yeah, the whole money fight, this blah, blah, blah. Don't get me wrong. Garbrandt is coming into that level of the super fight where he can, but he, you know, if you look at Conor, for example, Conor virtually cleaned out the featherweight division. Virtually. Frankie Edgar.
Yeah.
He's the only guy he didn't really fight.
Yeah.
Realistically, well, at the time. Now it's different. Holloway, I'd love to see Max Holloway, Conor McGregor fight again. I think that'd be fucking insane.
Yeah.
But Conor had done so much in that featherweight division.
Yeah.
Where when the opportunity came around, he went and he done it. That's fine. But for me at the moment, I also think Conor has to defend his lightweight title.
Yeah.
You have to. There's so many good fights at lightweight for Conor. He has to. So there's so many bantamweight fights now for Garbrandt. Defend your belt, man.
Yeah.
Like, I have to say, Garbrandt, he sort of went under my radar in a way. And now he's not under the radar. He's the big light that is shining on him. So go and beat the brakes off Dillashaw and let that rivalry commence.
Last 10 seconds. The question is Demetrius Johnson a bigger fight than TJ Dillashaw?
No, not at the
moment. I don't know if it is.
Maybe it is after he defends his belt.
That's it.
You're up.
True. So, next up. Jesus. Following Bellator 175 on Friday night, it was announced that King Mo Muhammad Lawal will face newly signed former UFC light heavyweight Ryan Bader. Do we like this matchup?
Yeah, it was obviously in the pipeline. I wonder, was it in the pipeline if Rampage won, he got him, or if King Mo won, he got him. Because Bader was right there like a hot rocket getting into the cage. To such a friendly stare down, amazing. King Mo was just ultimately respectful. He strikes
he's the man.
Yeah,
he's, the man.
He's such a nice guy. But he just strikes me as respect. Yeah, he had a back and forth with Fan Page, as he was calling him, Fat Page, wasn't he, or something?
Yeah.
But
to be fair,
yeah, it was big. That's what somebody put up. Yeah, titties as the last laugh. Remember?
Oh, no.
Yeah, remember?
Yeah,
remember,
yeah.
But look, yeah, it's we spoke about it on Elimer when we were saying that, you know, the card, the New York card, we were saying Lorenzo Larkin will probably be on it. We said Ryan Bader will probably be on it. These make sense to put card, and this fight makes sense. It is, King Mo obviously lost to Crow Cop over in Ryzen, so this was a good comeback fight against him, against Rampage. won the first round handily enough.
Yeah.
We'll talk about this a little bit more, I suppose. Yeah. So I won't go into too much detail over that fight. But yeah, for me, it's the right fight. It's a good fight for Bader. The wrestling may cancel one another out.
Maybe.
So, you know, it has the potential of being a bit of a snore fest the way Bader and... what's his name? Pink shorts. His name is left.
Phil Davis. Head.
Phil Davis. Why do I always forget Phil Davis?
I don't know.
I always forget Mr. Wonderful. So yeah, like I think it's the right fight. It's a good fight for Bader. It's a good fight for the promotion. King Mo was a superstar in Bellator. Ryan Bader was a top five guy in the UFC. Top five. That's fair, isn't it?
He was top five. Yeah. Plus so, the top four, you know, top three.
For me, fight makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense to me. I think a lot of people are saying that this is going to be a blowout for Bader. Possibly, maybe. It depends. Like, Bader has looked really, really good in his last couple of fights. I do think, stylistically, it could be a very difficult fight for Mo, because Mo's not going to be able to use that wrestling. He might be forced to stand with Bader. And we know Bader has some serious power. Now, he's not the most technical of strikers. He's not the best striker in the world, but he has that power, and King Mo has been finished before. It is probably the best fight he could have made. I don't think anyone really wanted to see the Rampage fight again. So I think Bellator kind of won on that one. Yeah. Obviously, Rampage now has to go to the UFC, so that probably wasn't in the...
That's what I mean.
But I think it's the right fight to make. As you said, King Mo is a big enough star. Bader coming from the UFC is a big enough star. It's a good addition to the card. I do like it. So, I think that's really it.
And as well with, like, New York as well, they are rolling out the superstars here. And Bellator, like, you look at it...
Are they going to spread themselves too thin?
No. No, I don't think so. They have an amazing card in London as well.
True. Between them two cards, though, you never know. You might get a couple of stinkers, you know, after those. Like,
well, I did say, you know, we were spoiling 2016 for fights, so 2017. But, like, with all the movement, like, I honestly think, you know, if certain fighters, like, as well, you're going to have Fedor and Mitrione Wims. That's in Dallas, isn't it? Boom, doesn't matter. No, don't expect to see...
New York.
Was it as well?
Yeah, go.
Is it? Oh, it is. No, is it?
Yes.
Yes, the co-main.
It's co-main. Jesus. Awesome. We spoke with it through a week.
Look, I'm tired after staying up watching WrestleMania. don't expect to see the return of Dan Henderson, even though he's not happy how his career finished. In a recent interview, the MMA legend said about his final fight against champ Michael Bisping, "It leaves a bad taste in my mouth with how I went out. I felt that I should have won that fight and retired as champion. I don't dwell on things like that. However, when questioned if he has the itch to get back in the cage, he shut the idea down. No, I don't have any itch," he said. "It was enough. 20 years of doing. If I had the itch, I'd go to the gym, spar my guys, and I'll be a... and I'll be dead for the rest of the day, and that will get rid of the itch." What's your thoughts on Dan Henderson, at least for now, wanting to stay retired?
I like it. There's so many legends of the sport right now who are coming back and they're saying, "Oh, I want to..."
Matt Hughes,
and then obviously Hoyce Gracie came back recently, BJ, and then you have Ken Shamrock, who was, you know, he's not retired, he is retired, he's not retired, yeah, he is retired. I like this. And speaking of Dan Henderson, he fought in the era when pay rose. So the likes of a Matt Hughes, I don't think the paychecks were there. And I've done a little bit of research on this because I wanted to see exactly why Dan Henderson wanted to stay retired. Is it the money? Is it the lack of wanting to compete anymore? And it honestly could be the money. If you look at the money he made in his last two fights, $800,000 in a win over Hector Lombard and $680,000 in a loss to Michael Bisping. Now also, the last one against Michael Bisping was a pay-per-view fight, so he would have got pay-per-view bonus on that. According to Dave Meltzer, the card done between around 280,000, 300,000 buys. And we know since the UFC contract came out with that Eddie Alvarez situation, when the UFC contract came to public, his thing was between 200 and 400 buys, you get a dollar for every buy. So Hendo was probably looking at another 260,000, 280,000 on top of that. Last two fights, he probably made a million, maybe just over a million. So he certainly didn't leave the sport broke. Unless he had a tons of bills, but he didn't leave the sport broke in terms of his last two paychecks. So, you know, he's probably sitting pretty with his money. I think he has a little bit of a UFC gig going on. So I like it. I don't think we need to see Hendo again. He's way up there in age. Doesn't need to prove anything. And hopefully he saved a lot of that money.
You know me about them coming out, and you know, fighters sometimes find it hard to walk away. It's great to hear Henderson saying that. He's still obviously heavily involved in the gym as well. Yeah. He's
Team Quest.
He's
going
down.
We have a Team Quest guy on later.
We certainly do. So, you know, he's going down and he can do it that way. So he's still involved. It's not like he's not gone from the octagon to the couch. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah, exactly.
It's,
yeah.
It's, he's still involved in the sport.
He's a lifelong athlete. I doubt that's going to be like that for those. Like,
Dan Henderson, you know, has competed since Jesus Christ was making bread and water and wine and everything. You know what I mean? Like, he's been in the game a long, long time, and happy retirement to him. And it's great. It must be weird. When we had Brad Pickett on, he was going near coming near the end. It was like, are you going to retire soon? Are you going to retire soon? Are you going to retire soon? And as soon as you retire, the question, you're coming out of retirement? You're coming out of retirement? So, you know, it's still, you know, it's both sides of it.
Yeah,
you know,
there's no both, win. Yeah.
But like with a legend like Henderson, I was glad to see him go out. It, like we always say, MMA is not a fairy tale. It would have been nice to see him go out in the win. It didn't happen.
He went out in a good performance in a title fight.
Yeah.
Like, that's crazy. Dan Henderson, who's, as you said, he's been around forever. He's held many titles, and he went out on a title fight for a shit ton of money. What a way to go.
Yeah. No,
and he could have won that fight.
I like it, because, like you said, Matt Hughes now coming back. Yeah. You don't want to see it.
Yes. Up next, the California, the former UFC lightweight champion, Rafael Dos Anjos, has his first welterweight assignment in the form of ex-Strikeforce welterweight title holder, Tarek Saffiedin. The fight is slated to feature on the UFC Fight Night 111 event, which takes place on June 17th in Singapore. Do we like this fight?
Yeah, RDA moving up. Be interesting to see what he looks like.
Yeah.
A lot of people have said he's looked bad in his last couple of fights.
Which he hasn't looked great in his last couple of fights.
Yeah, so it's a tough fight. Soyuz, Tarek will be a big welterweight as well.
Tarek is a big enough welterweight, yeah.
So, you know, it's a big move. It's interesting to see. Like, you look at other guys, like you look at, for example, Johnny Hendricks looks great with the move up.
Yeah.
Kelvin Gastelum looks great. Looks like Cowboy Cerrone looks like. Now, not that Cowboy ever looked bad at lightweight.
That's always the weird caveat. Yeah. Like, oh, but he looks great at 170, but he looked great at 55.
Yeah,
too.
Exactly. So, you know, you're talking about a former champion in RDA at lightweight. So, yeah, it'd be interesting to see him step into the octagon at the welterweight weight, see how big of his cut. Like, I'd be interested to see what he actually walks around at, what he'll actually...
He must walk around very heavy because he told MMA Fighting in January, I passed out 3 times making weight for the Eddie Alvarez fight. So if that doesn't say that it's necessary for you to move up weight, I don't know what does. And the next piece of news that I almost brought up is to do a weight cutting, so we'll talk a bit more about that, but that's definitely a reason to move up in weight. If you pass out 3 times trying to make weight, it's something that Johnny Jitsu spoke about last week on Just Getting On. A guy died because of it. It's a very serious business. It's not just you know, it's like you can't just cut weight, like it's serious business, you know. So he definitely needs to move up, but I'd be very interested to see how he looks, because if you're passing out trying to make weight, you're definitely not going to look great. You're not going to look at your best, and he's been finished a couple of times, and if you get finished when you're dehydrated, that's not good for your body. It's not good for your brain.
Well, you see, it's the old school mentality, isn't it? The guy who can, like Dominic Cruz talked about it when Joe Rogan spoke about weight cutting, and Dominic Cruz said, this is part of the sport. If I can cut weight better than you and be bigger than you on the night, that's a part, that's a gain for me and whatever. That doesn't necessarily mean it works for everybody.
Exactly, yeah.
I'd like to see fighters fight more at their natural weight well. The gas tank would be there. Like, there are some guys, like if you take Conor, for example, Conor looked like something from The Walking Dead when he was stepping on the scales, a featherweight, made weight every time.
Yeah.
But he looked terrible.
He looked awful.
Looked like a different guy the next day.
Yeah.
So people, the lads have it down. And you know, Conor would have spoke previously, and other fighters, not just Conor, would have spoke about how they done it. It wasn't an exact science a good few years ago, but now it is an exact science. They all have nutritionists, everything they put in their body, they're counting, everything they're drinking, everything they're doing. It is all aimed to maximize cutting weight and getting down to your fighting weight. But yeah, you know, I'd be interested. I don't like RDA. Will he make a run at welterweight? If you put him in there at the bigger welterweights, it's
RDA versus Wonderboy. That's huge size.
And if you look at him, he's getting hurt in his last few fights as well. Yeah. So, yeah. California State Commission Executive Officer Andy Foster are making an attempt to curtail severe dehydration and extreme weight cutting. And he and his team wrote up a 10-point plan. The plan will go up for vote at the next commission meeting on May 16th. The plan includes a fight day weight check, additional weight classes, and making repeat weight miss offenders go up a division. It was written in response to countless instances of extreme weight cutting affecting the health of fighters and loss of scheduled bouts. bouts, apologies. Do we like the potential changes? So this sort of follows on from what we were just talking about as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I don't know how you can't say that you don't agree with some kind of change that will stop, either stop fighters from cutting so much weight or at least put them in the right category, the right ballpark. Because I'm sure there's a lot of fighters who can make the likes of 155, but they just get too heavy. Mm. And then when they get too heavy, they don't start to cut, or they at least don't start to slim down early enough. And then you're looking at a huge weight cut. So I'm sure if fighters are being monitored that way, and you know, it might be tough for the fighter being monitored like that, but if the fighters are monitored that way, maybe they'll actually stay down near the weight class that they're supposed to be at. So I definitely agree with it. And California are doing a lot of this kind of stuff. They've done the early weigh-ins. They've done all that kind of stuff. So I'm definitely in agreement with this one.
I like the idea as well. If you've missed weight a couple of times, yeah, it's up a
it's
weight class.
It's a red
class.
Flag. Like, it's definitely a red flag.
But it's like we were just saying, it is a part that if you can do this, you can do this. Weight cut is a big issue because like some people can do it. And so obviously, with the tragic news with young Jordan Coward, is a young Scottish man fighting and living in Thailand, obviously passed away. It hasn't come out exactly what that is, but it is from weight cut, but then there's no doctor report.
Yeah, there's no exact cause.
Yeah, well, I haven't seen them as of yet. But like, that's obviously horrendous news, and you don't want to hear that. But at the same time, there are guys, like, if you think about it, like Anthony Johnson.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Welterweight.
He used to be a welterweight. Do you know what I mean? And you can see other guys, like, It goes the other way. Like, Rashad Evans won the Ultimate Fighter as a heavyweight.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So it goes the other way. But at the same time, I honestly think it has to be done. Like, the UFC were trying to implement fight week. You have to come in a certain percentage above your fight weight and stuff like that. So I think, again, you could almost go down the it's fighter safety aspect, because that cannot be good for your organs. The likes of your liver, your
definitely
kidneys.
Your kidneys, your liver.
And RDA saying he collapsed and he lost consciousness three times.
Yeah. Like, I think it's, think about this. I turn around to you and say, I'm going to go have a fight tomorrow. What I'm going to do today is completely dehydrate myself.
Yeah.
What would you say? You'd say that is absolutely insane.
Great idea, Rob, go for it.
Yeah.
I'm sure you would. Battered, though. But no, it is. Fair enough, they don't do it all in one day. It's
true.
But they cut down the water.
But they still dehydrate themselves a day
before. I think having to improve it and make it safer again.
Yeah.
Weight cutting, I think, will always happen.
It will. It'll always happen.
I think minimise the amount. Like, guys cutting huge amount of weight is unrealistic and is dangerous. But if lads are cutting a certain amount in fight week, I think that's where the exception's going to lie.
Well done for going over.
Sorry. So that was your quick fire news, brought to you by Fight Star Ireland, the fighter's choice. Check them out for all your fighter needs under the one roof. We are now going to get on with a certain man. So this is your Just Getting On with Johnny Jitsu, and we will be hitting Johnny up this week with how quick fans and media turn on fighters after the feat. You know, fickle. I always say fight fans can be fickle. Just as an example, this weekend, Paddy Pimblett lost his title in Liverpool, and he went from 6 months ago being touted as the next big thing out of the UK to be the next big guy in the UFC for UK fighters, to now he's the most overhyped guy, he's brutal, he's useless. And we just asked Johnny to basically talk about how fans react to defeats and how fickle fans can be. And forgetful of prior fights.
Yeah.
So here's Johnny with Just Getting On. Just Getting On with Johnny Jitsu. Who's the fuck?
Johnny Jitsu here. Just getting on for obviously Fight Talk, alright boys?
How's it going, Johnny? How are you this week, pal?
I'm good, good. Just chilling now before I go training at 8 o'clock.
A lot happened over the weekend in MMA, Johnny. One of the big things was people's criticism of Paddy Pimblett.
Yeah.
So it's something that we notice happens all the time, how fickle fight fans and even some media outlets are when a fighter has a defeat after hyping them for so much. They like hitting people when they're down. So what do you think of that, Johnny?
Yeah, well, I just basically, like I seen, like, just even the fans just turning on. Listen, mate, we're in a sport where it's like you're only as good as your last fight, unfortunately. Yeah. And, you know, Paddy was being talked about as being the next big thing going to the UFC, and there's an awful lot of hype, like, you know what I mean? He's carrying the whole of Liverpool there on his back, and yeah, it's a disgrace really how fans can turn straight away. But you know, unfortunately, we live in a society where, you know, it's opinions. It's an opinionated thing, you know what I mean? People need things to talk about. They always want to put someone down, you know? You'll never hear people rising up like when someone's just steadily going good. But the minute someone falls, boom, everyone's on it. It's you know, I feel for the kid because I know Paddy from the scene, from the European scene, fighting on Cage Warriors and stuff like that. And, you know, I just think there's a lot of people out there. We've got an awful lot of armchair fighters, you know, with big opinions and that quick to slate the lads. I would tell an awful lot of these people, you know, they should come and train in one of their local gyms and see what goes into this game and see the type of training, like, both mentally and physically that goes into it. Like, you know, I don't think they'd last too long, a lot of them, and I think they'd find a different respect for fighters after doing it, you know?
100%. And you look at Paddy there as the example we're using. Like, he basically sold out the Echo Arena in Liverpool. There was, I think, there's 6,000 or 7,000. I think it was the biggest Cage Warriors show to
And the
date.
Reaction that he got when he came out, it looked like a superstar reaction as well.
But what do you think, Johnny? You've obviously fought on home soil here as well in the Three Arena. What does that add extra pressure on the shoulders of a fighter?
Yeah, well, I think, like, come here, listen, Paddy went in there, he went 5 rounds with Nard Namani, like, that guy's training with top people, like, he's no pushover, like, I mean, that was a grappling war, that fight, you know, like, it's 5 rounds, like, if anyone, like, has ever experienced that type of fight, you know, they'll know how will-sapping it is and how much of a dogfight that is to get to the end there, like, you know, that was a very, very... It was a close fight, in my opinion. I think Paddy had, like, he got a couple of reversals and like, he looked good at points in the game. Even some of the stand-up looked good. But, you know, Namani just had that grappling style just to nullify Paddy on that night. And it just wasn't Paddy's night, you know. And it's as simple as that.
That's what I rewatched the fight. And, like, he had some great, as you said, some reversals and stuff. But, like, carrying Liverpool, like, you got to remember as well, this guy is 22 years of age.
22 years of age, lad. Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, he's only in the game really a wet week. And, like, you know, he's carrying, like, look what he's done already for the sport. I mean, he's reignited the whole mixed martial arts there in Liverpool. I mean, you know, from the times of the Terry Ethams and you know, Liverpool martial arts was buzzing. But it's had to get into a new spectacle there. I was actually over at one of the Shinobi shows, like, and I can see how passionate the fans are over there. They're very similar to the fans here in Ireland, and you know, it's a lot for the kid to have on his back. But I think this will be the makings of him as well, lads. I think, like, you know, losing a fight, it's not like as if it was like he went in and he got completely steamrolled by the guy. You know, he went 5 rounds there, like he's battling away, he wouldn't give in. You know, he was on them single legs and he was gritting it out. You know, it's a tough, tough game, lads. And that's 100%. These are lessons Paddy's going to take, and I think it will stand with him for the rest of his career. And I certainly wish him all the best. Like, you know, he's a great character for the sport, you know. He's outspoken. He puts himself out there. I mean, he's ticking all the boxes and he's doing the right thing. And I think his loyal fans now will stick with him. And I definitely think you'll see Paddy bounce back and bounce back bigger than he was, you know.
Yeah, perfect. Just we got a couple of questions for you, Johnny, from a guy on YouTube, Aiden Mack. So I'll go with the first question. Are you a better coach or a better fighter, do you reckon?
Well, I think, you know, I'd like to say, yeah, I'm a very, very good fighter, and you know, it's took me a long time, you know, to reach this point. I think I was only nailing on it the other day talking, and I started saying, like, we started out, we were fighting in little halls, and you know yourself now on the scene, and going from halls to even like a step up venues to like the basketball arena, and that was like, wow. And to think ever one day be fighting in the Three Arena in a martial arts, mixed martial arts spectacle like BAMA. I mean, it's one of the biggest shows outside the UFC, you know what I mean? If not the biggest outside the UFC at the moment. And it's, you know, it's the stuff dreams are made of, you know. I definitely have a long coaching background in this game as well. I think, like, even from the start when I was with Paul Cowser down in Rush Fight Academy, I was always lending my hand to a bit of coaching, because I think we were sort of all in the same place back then when we were all learning the game bit by bit. And I had done a bit of travelling. I went to American Top Team and that definitely brought my coaching level and my insight into the game up a hell of a lot further, and because I think we were a bit behind at that time. That was probably 2011 2012. And you know, just to answer your question, I don't know, I think it's going pretty even at the moment.
Brilliant, that boat.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it probably will come to a stage where, like, you know, coaching will be my full-time life, but I think it's definitely important as an athlete. I think you don't realise how special it is. This is a special time being alive here and competing as a mixed martial artist here in Ireland. We look back at this in years to come and go, fucking hell, that was amazing, you know? So I just want to keep this going at the top level as long as I can. I feel I'm only reaching my peak here as far as fighting goes, and, you know, I think my coaching hasn't even touched where that's going to be, you know, and I think that only comes with more experience and more knowledge being in the game myself, and, you know, it's always changing, and, yeah, I'm really enjoying it. So to answer your question, it's half and half there.
Half and half. Go on, you politician.
Sitting on the fence.
Have you any superstitions?
Superstitions? No, I don't really believe in any of that kind of shit, to be honest, man.
Nice and short.
I think you're the master of your own destiny, you know what I mean? If you believe it and you want it and you really, really want it, the universe will get it for you. And if you don't really want it and just kind of say you want it, well, then it won't happen, you know? So.
Well said. What's your two worst habits? I'm guessing habits in the gym. Or
two worst habits? Yeah. Probably sometimes I could be a bit better with that laundry basket in there, lads. She doesn't be happy with that. That's one. I'm probably leaving this batch bread out and I'll not put it back in the press. That type of shit, yeah.
Go stale, that's... Nah, fuck.
Where are we now? What are we only on?
Four.
Will you see it as a sad day whenever it's your last fight?
No, I definitely won't see it as a sad day. I'll actually see it as, like, when it is my last fight, I'll definitely announce that it's my last fight leading up to it, and I tell you, we'll have one hell of a fucking party, let me tell you. I'll be going out in style. I'll enjoy it, you know what I mean? It won't be a sulky day.
Number five is...
This is a controversial one, Aiden Mack.
I think this has been talked
this
about.
This is well publicised, I think. Yeah.
Were you ever stiffed by a promoter for payment? I'm pretty sure there's a couple of videos online about that.
Oh, listen, I'm not going to get into it. Listen, check the history on that.
Just ask Google that.
About the game, the insides and outs of this game, from a young age in this...
I think Aiden knows what he's doing.
Yeah, Aiden knew what he was doing there. And the last question then is, how many different bones have you broken fight-related?
Fight-related? Well, I broke my right wrist. And, I've tore my meniscus and fucked my ankle up. I broke my foot in a fight as well. In the warm-up area for Cage Warriors, I was doing some knees-ups and I slipped on the mat and I fucking broke my fifth metatarsal and I went down and fought with it like a bleeding Egypt. But it didn't work out for me. When the adrenaline dipped, when I got the break second round, I wish I got no break, man. I couldn't even walk on it. That was excruciating. I didn't like that now.
And there's fighter for you. Breaking bones and going out and fighting. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Listen, Johnny, it's a pleasure as always talking to you.
Yes, lads.
Kick some ass in Team Rhino tonight.
Yeah, well, I'm actually going to Malahide Martial Arts tonight. Tomorrow I'll be going to Team Rhino. We have a sparring class up there on Tuesdays up in Team Rhino. So tonight is like a technical boxing session. So I'll just start my week off nicely. A nice flow into Bam-a-Torty, this milestone event. Nothing too mad, too far out. I'm going to be enjoying myself and enjoying every minute of this camp, you know.
Well, Johnny, we'll talk to you next week. And thanks for coming on again, brother.
Thanks, man.
No problem, lads. Who's the fuck?
Absolute superstar. I thought I was going to have to say who's the fuck there. He teased it with us. But that was Johnny Jitsu just getting on. Any questions for Johnny, hit them up in the comment section either on Facebook underneath. And Johnny will answer them. Aiden, I hope you got some of your answers. And question five was a little dirty one. but we had to ask.
Yeah.
So moving on. So welcome back to Obviously Fight Talk, and I'm delighted to say we are now joined by a man that went viral, it's pretty safe to say.
Yeah, In the space of one day,
it went viral. A lot of people are talking about stuff he said. They should be talking about what he done in the cage, Bellator cage, at Bellator 175. We are now joined by Steve Thunderbeast Kozola. Steve, thanks for taking the time to come on to Obviously Fight Talk.
Oh, man, thank you guys so much for having me. It's an honor to be here. Pleasure. Thank you, guys. You guys are awesome.
Excellent. It's been not too long. How do you feel after the fight?
Feel phenomenal. I'm 100% good to go. I'm just waiting to get a call about London. Let's go. Let's make it happen. I don't know why there's any hesitation. It was less than 30 seconds. I'm healthy. I'm ready. I stay in shape. I stay consistent. Let's do it again. Let's go.
So I'm assuming that you haven't had any talks with Bellator yet about getting on the London card. They haven't called.
I talked to my manager, Tiki, and let him know as soon as the fight was over, like, hey, I want you to start working on this. I talked to the matchmaker and Scott Coker immediately, like in the cage. I told him I want London. So there's no secret about where I'm trying to go right now, and I don't see why there's a problem with me getting on there. I think the main card needs another spot filled out. I think I've shown that I can be a very exciting fighter who goes in for finishes, knockouts in particular. So let's make it happen. Let's go. Send me over.
You only have to look down your record and see exactly what you said. You are a finisher. Plenty of knockouts on the resume, submission as well. Talk to us about the fight with Jake Roberts. Coming into it, Rob commented when he was looking at it. It was a very Conor McGregor, Jose Aldo-esque finish where you caught him with the left hook coming in. Was that something you worked on? I've watched a good few of your fights back, and you throw to finish. But talk us just through that fight on Saturday.
Well, I came in very mentally prepared and very ready on all aspects, physically, mentally, spiritually, and my confidence going into that is always going to, be something that I carry with me. So I knew I was going to be the faster opponent. I knew I was going to be better striking, even though some critics said that he had better boxing than me. I had to go in there and prove him wrong. I had the best coaches. I have the best team. I have the best preparation around. I mean, my boxing coach, Manny Torres, is a phenomenal boxing coach. My teammates at Team Quest and all the coaches there, Oceanside Jiu-Jitsu. It's just an amazing championship environment that I have around me, which leads to finishes.
There's a lot of excitement around Bellator at the moment. Since Scott Coker came on, it's been kind of going leaps and bounds, and they've been signing up guys. You fought for Bellator back in 2015, and now you have your first fight back since then. How's it been different since the last time you fought in Bellator? Have you noticed any differences backstage? Has it changed any at all?
Everything's really just a lot more organized. I mean, they're obviously improving. They're getting better at what they're doing. They're constantly evolving with everything. So it's awesome. I love it. I love to see progression because that's always what I'm looking for, to make sure I'm the best version of myself. And Bellator is going to make sure they're the best version of themselves. And signing all these great new names, I think it's phenomenal for the sport. And it's really going to put Bellator on the map. So I'm honored to be back. I think I'm coming back at a just perfect time. And happen to have a great moment leading off, a fight in my hometown of Chicago, Illinois. Starting out the main card and showing a devastating knockout. So the stars are aligning finally, and I couldn't be more thankful, more blessed.
Let's talk about the viral video as well going around now of Jimmy Smith. Sort of seems like he snuck it up on you a little bit that Dillon Danis was sitting in the crowd. It was a very respectful call out, and also almost like a principal giving out to a student, sort of saying, come on, stop hanging around with the cool kids and trying to act like them. Well, was there? And were you aware that Dillon was in the crowd, that this was going to happen, or was this just a spur of the moment thing?
I was aware that it was going to happen. We talked about it a little bit. Pre-fight interview, I told him I wanted to call him. That's where initially it was like, I want to, this is a guy I want to fight if he's coming down to 55. I told him my beliefs in terms of him, not thinking that he is an authentic person, that he's copying Conor McGregor right now, and I just wanted to express my thoughts, and Jimmy Smith was kind enough to give me that opportunity, and we made it happen, and it's awesome. But I wasn't expecting for it to be so set up like that. I was planning on just myself getting on the mic and calling him out on my own, but the fact that Jimmy and Bellator guys were able to lead me right into it was awesome. It made it more professionally done.
Is that something you think about before the fight, if you get the win, that you want to get on the mic, you want to say something? Because it's been working for guys like Mickey Gall, who's been calling people out and stuff. And it doesn't have to be disrespectful, but there's a lot of guys who will get a huge win and then they'll just say, I want to thank my coaches, I want to thank this, and then people forget about them. Is that something that you think about, to say, I'm going to say something, this is my spotlight, I want to say something that will push me forward?
Yes and no. Yes, because the promotion for your next fight starts immediately once that fight is done. It's right then and there. So there's no hesitation. You got to be able to know what you want, where you want to go, who you want, and play out a couple different scenarios. But at the same time, do not be looking past what's right in front of you. That is your goal. You have to take care of business in order for the other thing to happen. So make sure you're not getting too far ahead of yourself. So I had an idea of that I wanted to be in London. I knew I wanted to call Dillon Danis and put him on blast for some of the things that I think are a problem. And then but never getting outside the fact that I have to make sure I have Jake Roberts in front of me. He's a tough fighter. He's got a great record. He's a good human being, and he's going to come and bring it. So if I don't come and bring it myself, then the whole post-fight interview doesn't happen if you lose concentration. So got to make sure that you're staying in your lane in terms of finishing and seeing what's in front of you, taking care of business, and then you can move on to the next thing.
And how realistic do you think the Dillon Danis fight is? Because you're quite experienced. You're 8-0. Dillon Danis hasn't had an MMA fight. He's done very well in jiu-jitsu. He's black belt. But how realistic do you think that fight is to happen?
I hope it happens. I mean, I wouldn't have said if it's not. I mean, if he can make 55, why shouldn't it happen? He's a Marcelo Garcia black belt. He's got plenty of titles. He's making all this money, apparently, and he's acting like he's, you know, the man. Let's go. Like, what's the problem? If you're this good, you're saying you're not fearing anyone, you got all these skills, then what is the problem? There shouldn't be a problem. But if he wants to fight some tomato cans, I guess that's fine. I don't get any pleasure out of fighting tomato cans. Like, that's not cool. I don't see any pleasure in that, so I don't know what's his thing with that. Or, I mean, can he even make the weight? Probably not, to be honest with you. I mean, he says he can make it down to 55. I mean, he was missing weight for grappling tournaments at, like, 170, doing catch rates of 180, you know? So I don't even know if he can make the weight. And if he can't make the weight, if he can only go to 70, that's fine. My teammate, Fernando Gonzalez, he'll eventually run into him, whether it's sooner or later, and he'll absolutely smash him. So either way, it's not going to work out in the long run for him. Maybe he'll have some short success, you know, because it'll give him 0-0, 1-0, 0-1, or, you know, whatever guys that aren't really well known or really well established, and they'll do his thing, they'll make their money, but man, eventually he's going to run into someone who's for real, and it's just not going to be a good night for him.
So if the Dillon Danis fight doesn't happen, realistically, is there anyone else out there? Because I can see on Twitter today, like you're saying here, you were talking about you want on London as well. So is there anyone else realistically that you'd be looking at, Steve, that you'd want to, that you think will progress you to the next? Because that's what from what I'm getting from what you're saying, it seems you want the guy that's going to progress you. You're not too interested in just fighting, as you said, tomato cans. You want the progression fight. So is there anyone else out there that you feel is next for you?
Absolutely. I mean, ideally, if I'm going to London, I would like to fight someone from that area. You know, I want to give, whether it's giving someone else an opportunity, whether it's someone who's already in Bellator, who needs a fight, you know, any lightweight European guy who wants to come in and fight me, I would gladly take the fight. You know, the closer to it is to the hometown, the better. You know, I want to come. I just had my amazing opportunity being a hometown guy. Now I need to give someone else that opportunity for being a hometown guy. But again, I'm coming in prepared. I'm coming in focused more than ever. So, you know, be careful. But realistically, I don't know any off the top of my head as far as like guys from London or European guys. But I do want to fight Adam Piccolotti for sure. So if they don't mind putting Piccolotti and me on the London card, I would love that. He's 9-0. I'm 8-0. He's a black belt in jiu-jitsu. And I'm sure people now want to see how I do against a black belt in jiu-jitsu. Can they get through my hands? Let's find out.
Are you looking to be quite active this year? I believe you only had one fight last year. Are you looking to be more active this year?
Absolutely. We got one down. I want to get at least another three or four, at least. I want to finish out. I want to be able to, by the end of the year, finish out my contract with Bellator. We'll renegotiate, and then we'll see what comes next. Let's do it.
How many fights do you have on that contract with Bellator?
Three more.
And is the lightweight division, it's so stacked in overall in MMA, not just in Bellator, not just in the UFC, just there's so many good lightweights out there. Is that something that you thrive on? There's such good competition out there to fight?
Absolutely. I mean, if you're the best in the lightweight division, you're one of the best pound for pound in the world. And you got to take great pride in that, and you also got to make sure that you're working your butt off to do it, because there's many guys, many amazing, talented, gifted, hardworking fighters in here, so I can't slag at all, and I won't. I'm going to always evaluate, improve what I need to do, make sure I'm working out, enhancing my strengths, working on my weaknesses, and getting after and make sure I'm coming in 100% ready to go every single time I fight, which is what I do.
And we got something here as well, because one of the funniest interviews you've done recently, or kind of articles that was about you, is about your nickname, how you came about, and it was more of a joke than anything, and it kind of stuck. So we thought, you know, it's a great nickname in my opinion, but you said it was a bad nickname. So we have a list of five here, and you can rate them on 1 to 10. 10 being a very bad nickname, and 1 being it's a good nickname. It's good. So Noel's going to call out the list here.
So 1 being horrendously bad, good, and 10 being very bad. So first up, we have Corey Beeston 25-8 Anderson.
We have what? What's the nickname?
Corey Beeston 25-8 instead of 24-7, basically.
He's beasting 25-8 instead of 25-7.
Too long.
Too long. Very bad.
So this is
way too long. Longer than Thunderbeast. It's too long.
This is one of Rob's favorite. Is Nick the Promise Ring?
Man, Promise Ring. I mean, no. I'm sorry. I mean, Promise Ring is just like, I mean, that's very like high school, like Promise Ring type of thing. Man, I'm married. Go for it. Like, all or nothing, man. You know, married with a kid now. Enough Promise Rings. That's not a thing. So that's going to be a below a five for sure.
Dan, the police officer cop.
It's a pun.
No good. That's below a five as well. I mean, hey, I won't even give Thunder Beast above a five. Let me put it that way too. I just want to point that out. I do not think my nickname is anything special. It's just one of those I was given, and I got to keep it now. You know, it's all good. So, and for those guys that these are your nicknames, I am not hating. I'm sure you're in the same situation where someone gave it to you, and you just got to write it out. It's all good.
We'll give you two more to rate, and then my favorite one. So, two more to rate. Logan, the Pink Pounder Clark.
Oh, my God, that's a zero. What, are you kidding me? Come on. It's not even clever. Classy in some sense.
Yeah. Steve, the Creepy Weasel Montgomery.
Creepy Weasel? Man, why are you putting yourself in the... Why are you naming... Like, that's a bad corner. You don't want to be in the Creepy Weasel corner. Why would you want to do that?
And my favorite. It's not on the list here.
They're real, huh?
Yeah, they're real. They're real people.
Oh, my gosh. What is this?
So, I'll give you a name and see, can you put the nickname into it? It's an Irish fighter. He was an MMA fighter, and he's now... He's a Thai fighter as well. Muay Thai fighter. So, his name is James Heelan. So, if your name was James Heelan, what would you make your nickname? Putting you on the spot.
Ooh. James Hellfire Heelan.
Oh, that's not bad.
It's James Sexual Heelan. And he comes out to Sexual Heelan.
I get it.
Yeah. At least it makes sense, I suppose.
Yeah, it makes sense. Yeah. Well, look, the Thunder Beast it is, and the Thunder Beast by nature as well. Stunning performance. Getting it done in 28 seconds is the official time against Jake Roberts. We hope you get on the London card. We'd love to see you welcome Dillon Danis into the MMA world. And we wish you the best of luck and your little man sitting on your lap as well.
Yeah, say what's up, Bubba? This is Mini Beast right here. Right?
That's Mini Beast.
Little Beast is going to come watch this. I mean, you think I'm making noise. This guy will make noise much louder than I ever will. I'm going to start him early.
We're away from him.
He's my man. But, you know, over everything, man, over fighting and everything like that, it's always about family. So being a dad, being a husband is always going to be number one and number one. So, you know, this is amazing. Thank you guys so much for having me on. It's an honor. It's a pleasure. It's amazing getting all this, you know, exposure and everything. And, you know, thank you so much to Bellator and Tiki for getting me on this platform. And It's. I'm gonna enjoy this ride, man. But you know, again, I'm gonna stay true to myself and true to my roots of, you know, hey, this little man right here, and providing for him and my wife and being a family man. That's who I am. That's my authentic self to my core. And I will never, you know, I will always work hard to honor them and making sure that they're proud. You know, I want to be this little man's hero more than anything in the world. So this is my bigger purpose. This is what I fight for. And this is why I'm getting finishes right here.
Very well.
I love that. From a fighter myself, I always ask fighters, does it give you that extra fire? After what you just said, we don't need to ask you that question. You've answered it in that statement. Steve, an absolute pleasure speaking to you. We'd love to speak to you again in the future as well. We hope you get on the London card, and thank you so much for taking the time.
Yeah, man. Let's promote that. Let's get me on the London card. I will come on anytime you guys will have me. I appreciate it. God bless you guys. Take care.
Take care, my man. Cheers. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
So yeah, ladies and gentlemen, Steve the Thunder Beast Kozola with his little boy on his lap as well.
Very well said.
Yeah, love it. Again, I was going to ask that question, you know, about family. You know, Chris Weidman speaks about it regularly. Keane Cowley now speaks about it regularly, about, you know, the extra drive to provide for the family as well. And there's no point in asking that question when he answers it.
Exactly,
Absolutely lovely guy. And, you know, he's very level-headed and down-to-earth. And
yeah, and if you haven't seen that performance, like, I'm sure if you're watching our show, you're pretty into MMA. I don't think we get too many casual fans at the moment. So I think if you haven't seen the fight, you've probably seen the call out.
Yeah,
go watch the fight.
Yeah, like, as I know, phenomenal. We spoke about Dillon Danis a lot there, and obviously, like, it was gone.
That's
of course,
that's
it was
what
a big call out
here about.
But like, the reason why the Dillon Danis came out was because of the phenomenal performance in the cage before.
Lovely left hook finish.
Beautiful. It was. You nailed it. It was very like the way
it was.
The way Aldo Rush McGregor was the very same. Yeah. Well, not the very same, but it was very similar how Roberts came in.
Yeah.
Because all he used was footwork and changed the angle and landed a beautiful
shot.
And
then
shot
when he went for
there.
The kill.
Yeah. Step, my big John had to step in.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was great chatting to him. And talking about great chatting to an up and comer. Nice segue and all. We have another up and comer. Coming up next, we're going to be joined by this man. Is the EFC, that is the Extreme Fighting Championships featherweight champion. He is a young Scottish man from Edinburgh. He wants on UFC Scotland. We're going to speak to him now with Danny Henry. Welcome back to Obviously Fight Talk, and we are now joined by the reigning, defending EFC featherweight champion, Danny Henry. Danny, welcome along to Obviously Fight Talk.
Thanks very much, guys. Glad to be here.
So, Danny, I'm just going to ask the obvious question straight off the bat. How does a man from Edinburgh get on to EFC and become the featherweight champion? How did that opportunity come about?
Yeah, it was an odd one. It was an odd one when it came about. Basically, I think the UFC were just sort of scouting for talent, and obviously for higher level, and the Dinky Ninjas are one of the stronger teams even in the UK. So they got in touch with James, and they asked if he had any featherweights available to sign. So James messaged me and said they're looking for sort of featherweight to build, and did I think I could make it initially, because I was a lightweight originally, and then I said, yeah, why not? We'll give it a go and see how it went. Signed a six-fight deal, and then six fights in, I had the belt. Well, four fights in, I had the belt. Three fights in, I had the belt. So, yeah.
I was obviously swatting up and reading up a lot about you as well. And you were the Headhunters FC. You won the vacant title there at lightweight. Now, I know you were talking about in the article I was reading, you were talking about the change from featherweight to lightweight. You were saying you were either going to have to bulk up to become a strong lightweight or make the cut. So was that a big... This is something we spoke about earlier in the show today, about weight cutting and stuff like that. Do you have a tough cut to featherweight, or has it become a process now that you have down?
It's getting easier. It's getting easier. Every time I do it, it's getting easier. The last two I've actually cruised down. That fight there was a late notice one. So I was about 79 kilos or something when I got the phone call a month out. And... yeah, just it helps. My teammates are good with that sort of stuff and knowledge. Stevie Ray's gave me a lot of insights into weight cutting and getting a method. So as long as you stick to the program, me making featherweight, it's not a problem. Even like with the rehydration stuff too. Like I'm a big feather, but I make it pretty comfortably.
Your last victory, of course, it was a title challenge. You got your title back. Was it a little bit sweeter because it was revenge?
I wasn't even fussed about the title, to be honest with you. I just couldn't... That fight was keeping me up at night. The first time I fought him, I felt like I never got out of first gear and gave a real poor account of myself. So, yeah, it was good to get in there and get the finish and take away his undefeated record as well. It was just a bonus.
Speaking about fighting in Africa, I was watching one of the... I think it was a preview for one of your fights, and I loved you were asked, what do you think of African MMA? Or said African MMA, and I loved the way you just said... I think it's lacking. I think us Europeans are better. What kind of flack did you get? Did you get any flack, any backlash from that?
I've had flack from day one over there, to be honest. As soon as you get in there and you're the foreigner, you're up against it. Like, I thought they've got the guy there that I took the belt off initially, Boyd Allen. He's like a household name over there. Everybody loves him. And the day I fought him, there was like 7,000, 8,000 Africans booing me, and that was for that fight camp. So yeah, I took some serious stick for that, yeah.
Do you not mind playing the heel?
Nah, not at all. Just it almost spurs you on. You want to just get in there and ruin the party a wee bit.
Obviously, UFC was in Scotland recently as well. There's been a Scottish influx as well in the UFC. UFC, was it last week before, confirmed that they will be returning to Scotland. So, being a champion of one of the leading organisation in the world in EFC as well, is it, you know, are you sitting looking at your phone saying, why hasn't this rung yet?
Nah, to be honest, it's still far enough away, but I'm confident I'll get the call. It makes sense. If they're going to sign anybody local, realistically, it has to be me.
Have you had any kind of contact with the UFC?
Not me personally, but they know about me and they know who I am. So I'm going out to Nashville with Stevie, to corner Stevie for the Lozon fight. So hopefully meet and greet about a few of the people over there and get them on side for the Glasgow card.
Is that something that comes as an advantage as well as a fighter, is having somebody in your gym that's on the show, that has been there, that's doing the cutting, that's your, like you said, you're going to corner now, that it all of a sudden, when you get the call and the phone rings and you step into the UFC, it's not foreign for you. You've seen it, you've been there, you've experienced everything except the actual walk.
This is it. Getting in, the experience, you can't replicate it. So that was a big thing. Getting over there and getting to see what it's like behind the scenes and stuff is going to be a great experience. I'm really looking forward to it. Excited for Stevie's fight too, because Joe Lozon's a bit of a hero of mine. I'm
absolutely love the man.
I'm excited for it. I think they're gonna bring the best out in each other, and it'll be some fight. It'll be fight of the night, guaranteed. So I'm looking forward to everything from my own personal perspective, for Stevie, for the gym, for everything. I think it'll be a great experience all around. So.
And you said that you don't mind playing the heel, but how good would it be to fight back home in Scotland?
Amazing. Be amazing. I was at the last one, and the atmosphere was unreal. Unbelievable. And all the Scottish fighters came out. You couldn't hear yourself think. You couldn't hear nothing. It was unbelievable. I'd imagine it's the same over there for the Irish events. The UK crowd seem to really get up for it.
Is that like with Scottish MMA? We've had Paul Craig on the show with us previously as well, and an absolute madman. But like, is like Scottish MMA, how big in MMA? Because we've had like the likes of Alan Philpott, Rhys McKee, and Norman Park from Northern Ireland. They always sort of talk about that the sport isn't pushed in Northern Ireland. They're not promoted by the media. Is it similar in Scotland, or does the media, local media, or newspapers back you guys?
No, there's been a lot of people contact me recently from local media. It seems to be picking up. I think it's difficult because it's not regulated sport or anything. It's hard to get the major media outlets on board. I'm surprised to hear that over in Ireland, because you guys are regulated and stuff over there now, aren't you?
Well, it's on route. They're working on it. It's set up, and it is in the process of that. But there's different.
Further ahead than the rest of the UK. So you'd have thought people would have started jumping on the bandwagon there a little bit.
I think it's more up Northern Ireland. Yeah. Like, obviously, Jesus, everybody and their dog knows Conor McGregor over here. He's well known. But like, it's the lads were sort of speaking from the Northern perspectives, which surprises me, because MMA is so big in Northern Ireland as well. But in Scotland itself, like, do you find like the younger kids, like, is there many gyms? Is it exploding up there as well?
There's loads of talent and stuff coming through. I don't know, there's plenty of shows. I think with the exposure of people like Conor McGregor, I don't know about you, but every time I speak to someone who isn't involved in MMA, first thing they'll say is UFC, MMA, and then the third thing's usually Conor McGregor.
Yeah.
So it's exploded, and everybody's starting to learn about the sport, so I can only see it getting stronger and stronger. But at the moment, we've got a really busy gym. We've got like 30-odd active fighters coming at a higher level just now. So.
And how did you get into it, Danny? Look, when you started out, what attracted you to mixed martial arts?
So I'd done little bits and pieces here and there. I'd done a wee bit of judo with my brother. I'd done a bit of boxing when I first moved up to Edinburgh. And then I started working security. I still do actually work security. And one of the lads I worked security with trained MMA. And he basically said, oh, do you fancy coming along? You've done a wee bit. And I went along to a club called Alba Dornadair. It was like a valetudo club, and just all the different levels, all the different disciplines just interest me, just gripped me straight away. I was just hooked. So yeah, that's basically how I got in it.
And was there somebody like in MMA, like obviously the young kids now, we're all saying about Conor McGregor, he's going to be, for young kids growing up, he's going to be the icon as well. But from you growing up, was there somebody you idolised and in a way formed your style of fighting? Is there something that you looked up to that you wanted to be like, if you know what I mean?
See, I've changed over and over again. At the moment, one of my favourite fighters is Joe Lozon's one of my favourite fighters. Yeah. That's what I'm saying about the Stevie Ray thing. I love
Jesus,
the guys.
Steve, are you Conor and Stevie? This could get awkward, couldn't it?
I know.
You're gonna be like, come on, Lozon, meet Stevie.
I love the guys that turn up and put on a show. There's nothing worse than watching these guys that come in and grind you against the fence. Nobody pays. You're stealing from the fans if you're going in there and you're grinding grinding out fights. That fight with Alan Patrick that Stevie had was infuriating to watch because it was just, he wasn't even trying to win the fight. So I like exciting style fighters. I used to like Thiago Alves, used to come in and bang, and
yeah,
loved his style of striking. Martin Kampman, people like that were the guys I used to enjoy watching the most. And Jose Aldo, obviously, as well. Jose's class.
Absolute.
If you do get the call from the UFC to do Scotland, is there anyone on the radar that you're looking at and saying, I'd like to fight this guy because he's an exciting style, or, you know, he'll get my name out there? Is there anyone in particular there that you'd love to fight?
Nobody in particular, but I tweeted that Andre Feely. I was trying to get a bite out of him, but he wasn't having none of it. I'm not too fussed. Anybody. Fight anybody in Glasgow. Said I'd fight my own mum, so I'd be getting some food for that as well.
Good Scots, man. Do you, a bit of a weird question in some ways, I suppose, but do you find, like, you know, I like a weird question. You're the champion in the featherweight division over in the EFC, but do you find, like, guys that, like, fighting on, let's say, Bama or Cage Warriors are getting a lot more exposure and media hype, in a sense, more so than you, and they mightn't even be champions of them promotions, but they're UK-based fighters or Irish-based fighters, and there's is hype thrown behind them, and here you are, 10-2, and you know, you feel a little, you're not getting the bigger slice of the cake that you should be?
Do you know what? I probably don't get the recognition in the UK that I deserve, but I think over there, I get loads of exposure, and that was the big thing for the UFC for me. Like, the production level is almost on par with the UFC. All the stuff they do is great, so it's great from that point of view. But yeah, there's guys in the UK that are getting mad exposure. Paddy Pimlet, look at the push he's getting at the moment.
How did you rate his fight on Saturday?
But did you watch the Pimlet fight?
Yeah, that's it. How did you rate it?
I thought it was a good fight. I thought Nad fought very smart. He looked good. Didn't think Paddy fought very clever. Kept going for that sort of head outside single and getting sprawled on. It was just odd. And then just sort of ran out of ideas, didn't he?
We were talking about it earlier as well, with Johnny. I don't know if you know Johnny Jitsu, Johnny Redmond, an Irish fighter here.
Who the fuck?
He's known everywhere, isn't he? So Johnny comes on with us regularly, called Just Getting On with Johnny Jitsu. And Johnny was talking about, we were sort of saying about how quick fans flip on fighters. Like Paddy Pimblett, 6 months ago, was seen as the next big thing. Yeah. Now, after his last two performances, people are just wiping the floor. No, he's done. He's finished. He's 22. But, like, what do you think is next? If you could advise Pimplet, what would you advise him?
Oh, I don't know. I don't even know what I'd say. To be honest, I've never been a massive fan of him. Quite arrogant and stuff, I've always thought. But I don't know. I don't know what he's going to do. He's Cage Warriors managed, so I'm assuming they'll pick some favourable matchups for him and he'll end up fighting for that belt again.
Probably.
Probably. No, it's just interesting to get the fighters' sort of viewpoint on that. Do you have anything? I know, obviously, we're throwing UFC at you. EFC will absolutely love us for doing that. But do you have anything lined up in the EFC? Is there anything coming up for you over the next few months?
The EFC have been brilliant, to be honest. They know about the Glasgow card, and they've already said, like, if it goes ahead, they're happy to let me out of the contract, and they almost want it to happen for me too. I've beat everyone over there. There is worth fighting, so there's not really any other matchups over there for me. So they've almost gave me their blessing and said, like, be great if you got in. On the flip side, they've said if July doesn't happen, they have scheduled something for me in August, but I wouldn't be able to say who or when. But there is something in line in August, so. Worst case scenario, I'll be back out in August.
Do they do any shows outside of Africa?
Not at the moment, no.
It's a fine and peculiar because our production, as you said, and the production is huge, you know.
Yeah, like it's massive.
We have Henry Felipe going over to fight. He's going back for his belt.
That's right. And Duplessis, Dricus.
Yeah, so I'll be honest, I first got into EFC watching EFC when Henry went over first to fight for them. The production value and everything in it is
looks great.
It is absolutely phenomenal. Hopefully the phone rings for UFC and you get the matchup. And is it a case of anyone who, it doesn't matter, I know you're saying touchy feely you were shouting for, but give me anyone on that roster and you're gonna take them down?
touchy feely his chin. Nobody. I'm not fast at all. Anybody in Glasgow.
Excellent.
Except my mum.
See, he's already welching on that look. He's taking that look.
I'm injured.
Yeah. Doesn't want to get a smack when he goes home.
Well, listen, Danny, thanks for taking the time to come on to us here at Obviously Fight Talk. We do appreciate it. Hopefully the phone rings, and if it does, hopefully we'll be the first ones you'll be getting in touch with to come back on and have a chat with. It's been an absolute pleasure chatting to you and getting to know you.
Thanks very much, guys. Appreciate it.
Have a good evening. Take care.
Guys, take care. Bye-bye.
So there you are, Danny Henry. We're traveling the world today, so we've been to Bellator, we've been to EFC, and now we could be going to UFC Breakdown. So UFC 210 happens this weekend. As we said, there was a lot of fights the last couple of weekends. It wasn't the UFC, you had your Cage Warriors, you'd have everything, but we are now going to go and have a look at UFC 210, your preview. We're going to be joined, as mentioned at the top of the show, by Darren Russell. Darren, of course, is a contributor for MMA Latest and the Odds Bible, so get your pen and paper down or just listen, because there could be some good tips, money to be made. So welcome back to Obviously Fight Talk, and we are now joined to break down UFC 210 going down this Saturday night, Sunday morning, whatever way you want to see it. We are joined by Darren Russell of MMA Latest and the Odds Boy. So Darren, thanks for joining us to break this card down.
No problem, thanks for having me on.
First thing, are you excited for this card?
I think it's sort of got lost in that hype of 211 as such, but it's obviously the main event that's the big draw, and that's the one that's going to sell it as a pay-per-view with Wahab and Mousasi, because you look at how Cynthia Calvillo and Pearl Gonzalez has got onto the card is sort of crazy.
Yeah, it's a bit mad. I'm excited just because there hasn't been a UFC card in a while. So sometimes when there hasn't been one in quite a bit, I get a little bit excited for the next one. But I think if this was kind of lodged between a fight night last week and then another card the next week, I'd probably be less high on it.
So we are spoiled for fights is what you're basically saying. And you're like a child that hasn't had a sup of Coke in 3 days.
Kind of, yeah.
Sugar.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
Yeah, it's fair point. Well made. I'm excited because Chris Weidman's on, and I'm Tim Weidman, so
fair enough.
That's why I'm excited. So yeah, you're opening. We're gonna pick it up from your main card. So opening up your main card, we have Will Brooks taking on Charles Oliveira. So what do we think of this one, gentlemen? This is I like the fight personally, but I'll let you have your opinion first.
Guest first.
Thank you very much. I think Will Brooks, the more it was sort of heavily hyped how good he was going to be coming to the UFC, how good he was on Bellator, sort of how easily he put Michael Chandler away considering how highly rated he is. But I've been sort of quite disappointed by the lack of action from him. He's quite content to drag fights out to a decision. I don't think he was that good up against Ross Pearson, to be honest. And I think he's still going to sort of cruise to a decision, but I quite fancy Charles Oliveira, despite his move from featherweight not looking too good in his first fight, obviously, with that loss.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think he came in with a lot of hype, and I do think it was warranted because he did look good in Bellator. But I don't think he's really hit the ground running. As you said, he didn't look great against Ross Pearson. Got the win. It was kind of it seemed like a guy who just wanted to go in there, scrape out a win on the first UFC appearance and get out of there. And in the second fight, I thought he looked okay, but kind of got hurt to the body and then got finished. I'm actually leaning towards Will Brooks in this one, just because I think he has enough grappling to get on top and stay on top without getting submitted. And maybe again, kind of grind out a decision. I don't really see it being that exciting. I do think that Oliveira does have some really good submissions off his back. But I do think Will Brooks is good enough just to stay out of those and do enough. Maybe land a couple of elbows. Maybe get the side control the odd time. But kind of just out grapple him on top. But I don't really see too much happening in this fight.
You sold me on Will Brooks.
He's a good fighter.
For a long time, you spoke about Will Brooks going, oh, he's going to be a killer in the UFC when he gets there. And he's as much as I said, I like this fight, it's when you sort of think about it, like Oliveira hasn't had much luck of late, you know, as well. He missed weight last time, wasn't that? And was bumped to catch weight, or did he miss weight?
I think he might have. Well, he's missed weight so many times.
Yeah, and he just looks like the Grim Reaper getting in there as well. Like he looks malnourished and he just needs a good sambo. And I just think Will Brooks here is going to three-round it, do what he needs to do to keep the action alive. He'll be warned and need action from you. He'll do enough to keep the position and he'll grind out the decision. But Charles, I think the thing with Oliveira is Oliveira can have that moment of magic. Yeah. He has done it previously where he's done some great things, and please MMA gods, let it be something where he makes Will Brooks have to enforce the fight, and it does turn into a good either stand up where they both of them cancel each other out with the jiu-jitsu on the ground from Oliveira and the wrestling from Brooks, and hopefully it's a bit of a stand up war to open it. But it's a pick 'em for me. I'm not too sure what the actual odds are. We can check that. It's Charles Oliveira on Skybet is 21-10 and Will Brooks is 4-11.
Short enough, isn't it?
But if you were picking, who are you looking at here?
I'd go, if I was a better man, which I am, it's got to be Charles Oliveira, but not Charles Oliveira, sorry, Will Brooks by decision. I think the key for me is if Will Brooks stops Charles Oliveira taking down, I sort of can't see how Oliveira is going to beat him.
Yeah.
But Oliveira, if he can get it to the ground, he can prove what he can do with, you know, he quite easily taps people out with a guillotine, yeah. Also gets tapped out himself by the guillotine. Yeah. So that's, I think, true. if he can get it to the ground, he's got a good chance. But I mean, Will Brooks takedown defense, I think it's something stupid like 86%.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's sort of the key to it for me.
And Rob, who's your pick? You're going Will Brooks as
well.
Will Brooks,
yeah, decision.
So yeah, we're gonna go. That's gonna be three for three there. This fight actually excites me, probably because I was watching MMA a long time ago, and these two guys were the big guys at the time. So Thiago Alves taking on Patrick Cote. This is Alves sort of coming back to, not out of retirement in a way, but he's had a lot of issues, and it's, you know, he's coming back again, and Cote. Sort of similar, really, isn't it? And these two guys, these could have fought.
They're both in similar positions in their career. Like, Cote has fought a lot more. I think Alves has had, this is going to be a second fight in 2 years.
Yeah.
So that's 3 years nearly. That's fairly poor. So yeah, they're both kind of at the tail end of their career. So it would have been great if we got this a bit earlier. Now, obviously, Cote was fighting at middleweight at the time, so it wouldn't have happened. But for me in this one, I just think that Alves hasn't fought enough. He hasn't been active enough, whereas Cote has. Now, Cote is coming off that bad knockout, and we don't know, a lot of guys that get knocked out like that and they come back and don't look good after it, but I just think that Alves just hasn't been active enough. So I'm going to have to side with Cote in this one, but it's again, it's not an easy fight to pick just because they're both in similar positions in their careers.
For me, it's a bit of a tough one. I mean, Cote, again, like you say, how's he going to come back from that knockout? It's the same sort of argument with Glover Teixeira, obviously, back from the Rumble knockout. But will he ever be sort of the same fighter again? I'm not too sure. Alves, I'd probably just side with him. I think if he can keep the fight standing, keep the range, he's got a decent striking defense. Cote absorbs a hell of a lot of strikes.
Yeah.
And I think Cote, I mean, look, they've had nearly like 45 UFC fights between them. They're both sort of coming to the late stage. I think Cote's reinvented himself, but it's hugely key to see how he comes back from that knockout.
Yeah, for me, it's this type of fight. This is the fight that Cote usually wins. It's this kind of era of guy. Like, he beat Joe Riggs. He beat Ben Saunders. Josh Borkman. Those type of guys where when he comes up against the likes of... He's just lost to Donald Cerrone. The kind of younger guys he loses. So that's why I'm going for Cote. I also think he's going to be the bigger guy. But, you know, it wouldn't surprise me if he goes in there and gets hurt, because who knows, as we said, who knows what he's going to look like after that knockout, because that was a devastating knockout.
I've always liked Alves.
Yeah.
I just like his style. He sort of, he can mix it. Like, he is known predominantly as the stand-up guy as well. I like his Muay Thai. His kicks can be vicious. He can be vicious in the clinch. I always talk about an expiry date on your chin. Not that what Cote was finished with by Cowboy was an expiry, but I just, coming back from that type of defeat, I just think Thiago Alves here could be the hungrier guy. Bit of a chip on his shoulder as well, a lot to prove. Coming back, you know, he's had losses. Carlos Condit beat him. Jim Miller beat him. So I just think Tiago Alves coming back. I like Alves in this one. I think his Muay Thai is going to get him over the line, and I'd say a stoppage maybe in the third round here for Tiago Alves. Tiago Alves outright.
He's about 5-1 for a knockout, which I thought was
Tiago Alves
incredibly good value. Mm. Yeah.
Oh well.
He's 11-8 to actually win the fight. Yeah.
5-1 for a knockout or TKO.
You've torn me. I'm going Alves knockout.
Was that easy? Was it?
Yeah.
Easy.
Show me the money.
So yeah, I've gone Alves. What way did you go?
I'm gonna go Cote for the win, but I might throw something on Alves knockout because that's a good price.
Classic Rob. Classic Rob.
Sit on the fence.
And Darren, you were going with Alves as well, are we?
Yeah.
And you fancy the KO?
Second or third round, maybe.
Ooh, there you go. Yeah, there, folks. Get on that 5-1. Yeah, I'm writing that down as a reminder for myself. Your next bout then in the evening, we move into the women's divisions. We got Cynthia Calvillo taking on Pearl Gonzalez. I'm gonna throw this one to you guys because Carl loves the women, but
I thought that Calvillo was quite good in the last fight. That was the one where she got that transition from Darce into back, which was absolutely amazing. But like she's 4-0, and I believe Pearl is 6-1 or something. So it's kind of difficult to really make an educated pick because there's not barely any tape on Pearl, and there's limited tape. The only fight that I can really find is that last one for Calvillo. I'm gonna go for Calvillo because all I've seen from Pearl was that she grappled in her fights, and she was against really lower level competition who didn't really look good, making mistakes in positions, and it wasn't a good look. Whereas Calvillo really impressed me with her jiu-jitsu in the last fight, so I have to go with Calvillo. But I do agree, it's kind of a weird one to be on the main card, and there's definitely fights on the card that could be put into this position over this one, so I do agree with you there. But I'm looking forward to seeing Calvillo because I think she's a bit of a prospect in the strawweight division.
Yeah, I think it's a weird one to put it on a pay-per-view. It's as if they don't want to sacrifice the quality of the prelims.
Yeah.
Maybe. And I think bumping up, I don't know, maybe the only one I can think of is maybe the Jan Blachowicz and Patrick Cummins fight that could definitely replace it. But how many pay-per-views would that sell? You know, how many people would? It's not particularly a fight that's.
It's not going to sway either way. You're not going to get people to buy, but it's more of a stature thing or a status thing to be on the main card, I suppose.
That's it, and I think Cynthia Carvalho, like you say, she's only 4-0, and Pearl Gonzalez first fight in the UFC, and she beat Courtney Casey before, which is a bit of good experience for her, and she's obviously a little bit more experienced, but I think it's going to go one way or the other by submission. I'm not sure which way it's going to go, but that's 2-1 for either of them to win by submission, which I think is a pretty
Noel's just writing down all these odds and reminding himself.
but it's also a mad, there's a weird market bet victor offering, which is for the quickest fight on the main card. And this is at about 11-2. I can't see many fights being finished too early.
Yeah.
But I think both girls would be quite eager to put on a show.
Yeah.
And try and get a quick stoppage like Cynthia did in her first fight against Amanda Cooper.
Yeah. I think as well here, obviously coming out of Team Alpha Male as well, Cynthia, that I think, you know, the UFC, let's be honest, they like pretty girls fighting that they can market. This could certainly be a tactic. Now, you know, I'm just saying, you know what I mean, what they could be thinking. But no, let's be honest, they done it with Paige VanZant. It didn't work out that great. She's good dancer. But, you know, it could be a tactic they're doing to build them up for future. The likes of, you know, they've done it with Mickey Gall and stuff, promoting them, putting them.
Mickey Gall's a pretty girl.
He's a pretty boy, and so is Sage Norco. They're putting them higher up on cards where their record would perceive they should be.
Yeah.
So I think certainly that could be the UFC's thinking in Cynthia. You know, we've seen it blow up in their face with trying to promote like Ronda as much as they did. They didn't put as much promotion into Amanda Nunes. We all know how that went. I think this could be the UFC just excuse a terrible pun, boxing clever by putting the two ladies on the card at this point. But I'd go with Cynthia because I think they are going to try push her. I don't know anything about Pearl, to be perfectly honest. So I'd go with Cynthia just because of that transition. To be perfectly honest. Good work. So, yeah, so I'm going with Calvillo. And are we all going that way?
I'm going to be different and go for Pearl just based on the experience. And look out for an arm lock, maybe.
Yeah, I've seen that on the record as well. I'm on my way, you, Shelton.
I'm going to go away, Cavillo.
Cavillo as well. So Rob's with me. Your co-main event of the evening is Chris Needs a Win Weidman taking on Gegard Mousasi here. I think this is a great fight. Ranked 4 and 5 in the division. Gegard is on an absolute tear at the moment.
Chris Weidman is not.
Has ran into a wall in his last fight, basically. I don't think he would have been as hurt if he ran into a wall. So what do we think of this, the co-main event of the evening?
I think it's such a pick and fight. It's so difficult to sort of, it's for Weidman, you've sort of got to look at how is he going to win the fight bar being cautious, because that's basically what caught him against Joel Romero. He was fair and okay.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden gets caught by the flying knee, but he's got to, I looked through Mousasi's stats before and he hasn't been taken down in 7 fights, which... It's got to be the key for Weidman to sort of win the fight. Uses wrestling. Last person to take him down was Yakare, and that was 2014.
Yeah, Jesus.
And Weidman's the key to that is as well. He's not really utilised his striking as much as he did in his earlier days, pre to him getting the title shot. It's like he's sort of cautious to use his striking. It sort of got him to the position he's in.
Yeah.
And I think he needs to sort of get back to finding that range. But I'm just struggling to see how he can beat Gegard Mousasi.
Yeah, it's a weird. I do agree. It's a pick'em. Like, I think experience is weird because people always forget how young Weidman is in the sport. Like, Mousasi has around ish 3 times more wins than Weidman has fights, which is insane to think about. Like, Gegard Mousasi has been everywhere, and he's so experienced, and this is probably the best run he has in his career.
Yeah.
Traditionally, though, the type of fighter that Mousasi loses to is someone of Weidman's stature and someone of Weidman's style, someone who can grapple him, who can kind of stop him getting into his game, the likes of a Jacare, the likes of a King Mo. But again, that's a long time ago. Just that's 2014, 2015, then even earlier for King Mo. So. It is a difficult fight to call. Who knows what Weidman's going to look like? 2 knockout losses in a row, and that's always a big thing. So I can't pick just yet. I need to think about it more. So you can talk for a little bit.
I'm going to throw into it. I think Chris Weidman in his last 2 fights, in a way, has been unlucky. Hear me out. Luke Rockhold, for example, he was winning that fight, and then for some reason, he thought he was Jackie Chan or Bruce Lee, and he tried to throw spinning shit. I thought it was a close fight, but I think Weidman was winning the fight.
But then he got pummeled.
Yeah, Luke Rockhold took full advantage of it. How that fight didn't get stopped, and he was allowed to walk back into his corner and come out for the 4th round was beyond me. Then Yoel Romero, it was, again, a competitive fight. And then that knee, That's putting a tank down, never mind Chris Weidman. And I think going into that fight, of course, it was the historic New York card that Chris Weidman pushed for an awful lot. Yeah, he was a big ambassador for MMA coming to New York. I think there was a huge amount of pressure on his shoulders going into that fight as well. So I think you have to look at that as well. Gegard Mousasi, normally when I'm breaking down Gegard Mousasi fights, Darren, I just go, I don't need to break this down. Gegard's just going to win. But with this one, Gegard can turn up, and then other times he's just off. He's like, you know, it just this switch just doesn't flick for him or something, and he just doesn't have it some nights. And I think fighting Chris Weidman, I think this is going to be, you know, you were saying Weidman's going to away from his striking. He's sort of relying a little bit more on his wrestling and sort of playing safe in a way. I think this is going to be a very dangerous Chris Weidman. This is a Chris Weidman who was 2-0 in his last fights. He's in trouble. His back is against the wall in that sense.
Yeah.
And I think this could be a very, very dangerous Weidman. Yes, I'm biased. I'm a big Weidman fan, but I'm a big Mousasi fan as well. I think Weidman is going to come out and he's going to go back to that striking, but he's going to mix it up. Use a striking to get in and close the distance, get his weight on Mousasi, tire him out in that way. And I can see Weidman edging it over 3 rounds in this one and getting the judges' scorecard and getting back in the win column. I'm going Weidman by decision. Turn into you.
I think Weidman, I think it's a case of how much does he go and risk it and how much does he go and play and save? Because if he risks it and gets caught, all of a sudden he's 0-3. All of a sudden Musasi's just knocking people out left, right and centre. So do you try and play it safe and shoot for the takedown? But then he tried to do that with Yoel Romero, gets caught by the flying knee. There he's 0-2. So I think there's a bit of value in Weidman to win by decision is about 21-10. Okay value, not great. Whereas Musasi's 9-2 to win by knockout or TKO.
Definitely better value.
Better value on the odds. But what's your thinking on whether what is your pick on it? Come on, you're staying in your corner. You're being quiet.
I have a pick. I'm gonna go with Weidman by decision. I think if it was five rounds, I'd go with Musasi. The reason being, I think that Weidman's gonna be able to do enough to keep Gegard Mousasi from getting into his game for enough. Gegard Mousasi sometimes, as you said, he can show up and sometimes he can't show up. If he doesn't show up for the first round and Weidman can get a first round in there, I think it could be tough for Mousasi to get back in it. So that's why I'm going to go with that. If it was five rounds, I think there would have been more time for Mousasi to catch him because Mousasi has looked really good with his hands and with his kicks lately. And a lot of the time, you know, Musasi would just kind of grind out decisions as well. But I think lately he's looked really good with his striking. So I think over the three rounds, I just can see Weidman just scraping it.
Hope you're scraping right. And Darren, who are you jumping at? Who's your show? Just to write it on the piece of pop here.
I'm going to go for Musasi, sort of. I'm going to go third round knockout. I just think if Musasi can avoid the striking, avoid getting taken down like he has done for seven fights, but as he fought a wrestler of Weidman's stature since Yakare.
Yeah.
Yakare took him down, and that was the last time, you know, someone was able to take him down.
That's some stat, 2014.
It ended badly as well, though. The Yakare one ended badly.
Exactly.
Yeah, so great fight. I really like this fight.
Your main event of the evening, the tasty one, you got Daniel Cormier defending his title against the number one ranked opponent. Against him is Anthony Rumble Johnson. Obviously, they're doing it again. The first one, DC gets the nod. Obviously, the big question the last time was Anthony Johnson, his own corner, was screaming, "Do not give up, don't quit." That must have just absolutely steamed up Daniel Cormier here on that one, his corner shouting. But Rumble Johnson has got what not a lot of people have. He's just got this death touch. He landed the death touch and Cormier's spirit rose and somehow stayed in the fight. So do we see it playing out any differently here?
I think it's, again, like you say, Rumble threw the best shot he could. A lot of people haven't been able to take it, but Cormier took it and got back up. It's a question of how much does Anthony Joshua, that'd be a completely different fight, Anthony Johnson. What does he put into going out there to finish him, or does he focus more on taking his cardio into the latter rounds? Yeah. And I think big reach advantage, but Cormier can drag fights to the later rounds and even to a decision if he wants to.
Yeah, it's what I find tough about this one is what adjustment will Anthony Johnson make, because there's a lot of people talking about, oh, he kind of he jumped on him and he gassed out. But a lot of time that's his game and that's how he gets fights done, that's how he finishes fights. So if he's conservative and he doesn't want to, you know, once he has him hurt and he doesn't try to finish, will that be detrimental to him winning as well? So it's kind of a double-edged sword there. But we also seen in a couple of Johnson's fights, mainly the Nogueira fight, where he did hurt him, but he stayed at range and he's you know, finished him. But it seems as though Johnson sometimes, when he gets somebody hurt, he does jump on them. Most of the time he does finish. I think Cormier is the exception.
Exception to that rule, yeah.
Does he make that adjustment to not jump on him if he hurts him? That's the weird kind of, you know, it's a double-edged sword there.
I think Daniel Cormier is a special fighter. I think Daniel Cormier would be spoken a lot more higher in people's opinions if there wasn't a man called John Jones. I honestly feel Daniel Cormier is underestimated, and in a way, like in by everybody, in a way, like, you can't, everybody will even question, is he really the champion? Because John Jones isn't there. I honestly think Daniel Cormier is one of the best fighters on the roster at the moment. He has this style. He can kickbox with you. He can take you down. His wrestling, like what he done throwing Dan Henderson around, it looked like, you know what I mean, a grown man with like a child, the way he was throwing him around, picking him up and slamming him. And like, you know,
it was like a wrestling match.
Yeah, he took these Anthony Johnson down and grinded him out and beat him up. Like, he got a lot of people talk about, like, he got hurt at one stage by Anderson Silva, but you look then what he done to Anderson Silva. Like, Anderson Silva, yes, it's not Anderson Silva from a few years ago, but I just think Daniel Cormier is a special type of fighter. He can do it all. He's a stunning mixed martial artist, and I just think he has Anthony Johnson both mentally by the whole don't break thing. Like, Anthony Johnson knows if he doesn't put him out, that DC will be in there for 25 minutes.
Well, that moment, I'm not sure if it was the end of the first or second, when Cormier was all over him and he was on the ground and he was landing the big shots, and when he stood up, and then you could see Johnson standing up, and he found it difficult to stand up. There was blood running down his face, and it looked like he was just a broken man, and it really did. And that's no disrespect to Johnson, but that's what it looked like.
Yeah.
And then obviously we've seen what happened in the rest of the fight.
Like, you cannot rule out, you know, these 4 ounce gloves, Anthony Johnson lands on the chin. You can't rule that out. Like, Anthony Johnson is so explosive. Ridiculous. And powerful. And but I don't know. I honestly think if John Jones didn't exist, I honestly think Daniel Cormier would be spoken of so much more. And I want Cormier to beat Johnson to get him to fight John Jones if John Jones puts the white powder down. I just want to see Daniel Cormier beat the brakes off John Jones.
Cool.
Well, that's it. It's I was at UFC 200, and the way the crowd booed DC, I was just stood there like, what is going on? You know, who expects someone who's a wrestler to go and stand and trade with Anderson Silva? It just doesn't make any sense. And it's again, like you said, when Johnson's corner turned around and said, don't give up, the switch went in Cormier's head to know he was on the verge of giving up. And it was such a lazy, easy way to give up that fight, which, again, it's got to question his cardio. Mm. If that was only in round three, what can DC do in round four? And I think the odds, obviously, Annie Johnson's big odds to win by. Everyone's expecting KO round one, round two. He's about 13-2 to win in round two.
Tasty.
Not bad odds at all.
No.
DC's about 13-2 to win by decision. So pretty even, but which one would you more side with, you know?
What's Cormier on the TKO knockout? I'd be interested in that. Yeah. The latter rounds to get the job done in round three DC knockout or TKO.
That's it. A rear naked choke's 5-1 as well. Yeah. Any time in the fight for him to win by rear naked choke, it's 5-1.
Yeah, there's some decent value there in those bets, I think. But I do agree. I think DC is just going to have a little bit too much for Johnson. I think it's going to look similar to the first fight. Yeah. I'm sure DC will not want to get hit like he did in the first fight. And if he does, as you said, Johnson has that power just to turn the lights off. But I think DC, and as well, DC, talking about people quitting, DC is not going to quit. There's no chance in that. If you look at DC in his life, not even in MMA, that guy's been through the mill. He's been through everything, so he's not going to quit. So I'm definitely going with DC. I'm thinking a stoppage. Some kind of stoppage, probably maybe a rear naked choke, something like that, you know, similar to the first.
Yeah, I'll go with DC in the fourth, I think. I think Johnson will conserve a little bit more energy this time. But again, if he doesn't go out swinging and doesn't go out to try and knock him out, what other way is he going to win? He's not going to be able to outstrike DC over five rounds. Even that was proven in the first fight. DC was a lot more efficient with his striking.
Yeah.
I think he landed nearly 80% of his strikes in the first fight, which he doesn't get a lot of credit for his strike, because he's known as a wrestler and he grinds fights out, but he really is a very good and efficient striker. He doesn't waste his energy on it.
And do we think that's going to be the game plan as well here, that DC is just going to close the distance and take Johnson down and get him tired by putting him down, get up, putting him down, get up, because he could go for days doing that.
Mm. Yeah, I think that's got to be his plan, but Johnson can also defend takedowns as well, there's nobody better than DC to try and break them.
Yeah. And if you look at one thing that Dan Hardy pointed out in his breakdown of the fight, was that if you look at DC's stats, his takedown percentage isn't amazing, but that's because he has so many takedowns and he chains takedowns and he looks for so many. So that's kind of deceiving as well.
Yeah.
But amazing performances by Johnson takedown defense. Like, he does get taken down. The problem with Johnson is he'll defend a lot of takedowns, but when he gets taken down, sometimes he can't get back to his feet and he gets hurt. So yeah, I'm with Cormier. One thing that we do on the show is we look at some of the fights on the undercard. We call it under the radar, and just pick a couple of fights that we think are interesting fights. Maybe if there's any good bets on the undercard as well, you can point them out. But I'll let you go first, Darren, since you're the guest. Any good fights there?
I'm looking forward to seeing what Magomed Bibolatov. Yes, I think that's how you pronounce the name. He's a huge favourite with the bookies. Yeah. I mean, World Series of Fighting champion. He's fought on the Akhmat fight cards in Russia.
He won a tournament there, didn't he? I think he won
the tournament.
Yeah.
He's a lot more experienced than Janel Lauser, but I'd add him onto an accumulator definitely. But as far as a single bet, he's 4-1 on. So there's not a lot of value, and Janel Lauser doesn't have a lot of high level experience. Yeah. Got a unanimous decision win. Doesn't look very convincing fighter. Might make me eat my words.
Yeah, possibly. But I think he's a great great prospect as well, coming from WSOF. I'm very high. He's good everywhere. Good on the ground. Good fighting backwards. Good going forwards, and powerful as well. But I'm really interested in that fight. I do think this is a bit of a. Not a can, but I do think it's if they give him a fight to let him get a performance in.
Well, that's it. You only think how many more fights would it be if he goes and wins this one? He might have two more fights before he gets a shot at Mighty Mouse. Mm. Because who's next for Mighty Mouse? It's just a bit of an empty division.
Cody Garbrandt, really. Apparently.
I'd like to see that.
Yeah.
We were talking about this earlier, and we do a segment quick for news. Would you like to see that ahead of Garbrandt Cruz 2 or Garbrandt Dillashaw?
I'd like to more see Mighty Mouse step out of his comfort zone, go up a weight, because if you look, I think he got beat by Brad Pickett, didn't he?
Yeah.
At bantamweight. So it'd be interesting to see if he went back up a weight, how he would fare against, especially someone, I mean, how good did Garbrandt look against someone in Dominic Cruz, who's highly respected as one of the sort of best mixed martial artists?
Yeah, I think it's a better fight for, not a fight stylistically, but I think it's a better fight in terms of entertainment to see Mighty Mouse go up or Mighty Mouse fight somebody of that stature rather than Garbrandt go down. I would like to see Garbrandt fight Dillashaw, but I think it's better for Mighty Mouse to get a fight like that. One of the fights on the card that I'm looking at is the Sean Strickland fight against Usman. I think Sean Strickland's a really good fighter, really good kickboxer, very exciting. Got a good win in his last fight. Tom Breeze. Yeah, two very good prospects, looking very alike, so it was kind of confusing. But it was a very good performance. I'm looking forward to that fight.
I'm going to go with just Patrick Cummins. He always seems to be either on the winning side or the losing side, and they're fairly matched fights. Quite funny that you have them both on the website here as ranked number 12.
Really?
So Yang, here we go. Blakovic.
Nailed it.
Can tell you, I should become a ring announcer or something. I swear to God. Cummins, you know, the guy who went from, you know, the
Starbucks or something,
the Starbucks to the big show against Cormier, and we all know what happened there. The odds Bible here, if you were telling people to quick accumulate for guaranteed money, guaranteed money.
Well, printing money, I'd probably avoid DC and Rumble as a bet altogether because I wouldn't want to ride all my money going into that last fight, because it's like we said, it's a pick and fight. I'd definitely throw Bibolatov on the bet, 110%.
Yeah.
Probably Charles Oliveira as a bit of a booster. He's 9-4 just to win. Then maybe I think Usman's probably I'd probably throw those three on as a bit of a treble.
Very nice. I'd say he's a good price too, Usman. He's a decent price. Very nice.
So there's your odds.
Put your money on it.
There's your odds, there's your money. And if it doesn't win, it's... what's your handle on Twitter there, Darren?
At DRussellMMA to give me a load of abuse.
Yeah.
People love to do it.
I'm sure they do.
Yeah, well, that's the thing when you give somebody a tip, isn't it? Yeah. It wouldn't win. You told me it would win. Huh? Well, sorry about that.
Yeah. Just don't put your mortgage on it. You'll be fine.
Yeah.
Just a couple of pounds.
Yeah, just a couple of pounds.
Just a couple of easy pounds. Yeah, easy pounds.
But stop.
You spoke about 211. Just to try you on the spot here, what fight are you most looking forward to on 211?
It's got to be, I think it's Aldo Holloway. Is that 211 or is that 212?
No, that's 12.
Oh, is it?
Yeah,
oh,
that's 12.
Got me excited.
Yeah. I like Eddie Alvarez, Dustin Poirier.
Yeah, that'll be a great fight.
Yeah.
Interesting to see how Alvarez comes back, really, from talking himself up as one of the best in the world and how he's the best in that division. And then, I mean, totally outclassed by McGregor. Yeah. And Poirier is dangerous.
Yeah.
He's not an easy fight to come back on.
100%. A great one here as well is Frankie Edgar, Yair Rodriguez. That's a cracker. Yeah, 211 is an absolute. It's only when you are giving out saying, it's not a great card. I'm going, 210's a great card. It's only when you look at 11, you go, oh, yeah.
I never said 210 wasn't a great card.
You weren't excited about it.
I said I was excited. You weren't even listening to me.
I don't.
Frankie versus Yair is a great fight. Because they're the fights Frankie Edgar always wins, but how dangerous does Yair Rodriguez look?
Main event as well. Miocic against JDS. Good fight. And the co-main event. Ian Jacek against Andrade. Andrade has looked phenomenal.
Yeah.
Phenomenal.
We will talk about this more on upcoming shows. So I'm looking forward to 210, even though Rob's not. So listen, Darren, thanks a million for taking the time. Coming on, break it down. Check you out on the Ozbob as well. Give all your handles there and everything where people can check you out as well for your tips for guaranteed money.
Yeah, so Twitter's at DRussellMMA. Same with Instagram. Feel free to tweet me abuse, tweet me questions. Whether you're fancying a little outside one, 80-1 for a draw with DC and Rumble.
Ooh.
Just throw £1. If you want to throw an odd pound on that, just £1.
£2. You'd be sick if you only threw a pound on it. You'd be sick.
And that's how it starts.
Yeah, and these new 12th are gone pound coins now. And see these new coins?
No.
I was watching Gogglebox last night. The new pound coin. Wait, it's not out yet, is it? It's they're bringing out a 12-sided coin. It's going to be a nightmare in your pocket, isn't it?
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm going on a weird tangent.
Good side note. But, it'll affect vending machines.
Yeah, big time.
Who didn't even think of a vending machine?
No, unbelievable. And that pound, original pound coin, has been around since 1983.
Gogglebox.
That's where I get all my knowledge. Listen, Darren, thanks a million for taking the time. We look forward to criticising you if your bets are wrong. Or we also, in the same hand, look forward to thanking you for making us guaranteed money. So again, thanks a million for coming on.
Thanks for having me on. It's been great. Thank you.
Cheers, man. Take care. So yeah, folks, guaranteed money. Money in the bank. So it was Darren Russell MMA. If it's not money in the bank. So Rob, let's sort of have a quick recap of the weekend.
Yeah, let's get through this really quickly.
Weekend that was. So this is your weekend roundup. And Cage Warriors 82 went down the first show earlier on Saturday. And this was, of course, Paddy Pimpett taking on Nad Narimani. Sold out Echo Arena. Paddy Pimpett didn't get the judge's nod.
No, we spoke throughout the whole show. If you haven't been listening, if you're only tuning in now, we spoke quite a bit about this fight with Johnny. And as well, we were spoken
with
as well.
Yeah, we spoke with, obviously, Danny Henry spoke about it a little bit
Danny
as well.
Was, yeah.
But
yeah, there's not too much else to say about it. I think he should be given time
100%.
Because he's 22. He certainly has time to grow.
Yeah.
Still a big star.
I was still playing with G.I. Joe when I was 22. For
I'm sure you are. Still watching wrestling.
No.
You know, not the best.
Sorry.
Not the best performance, but not the worst performance. Well, look, against a tough guy.
He's a solid guy, you know what I mean? And like, this is the thing, right? Is that hype is a thing that happens with a lot of fighters when they get a lot of wins together. Where you will see, like, if you look at Paddy Pimpett's last defeat, it was against Cameron Els, I believe. Was it? I'm right in saying that. I mean, let's check.
His last loss. Last loss. Yeah, I think it was, yeah.
He got choked out in a dart choke.
Yeah, that's when he looked even younger.
Yes, Cameron Els. It was Cameron Els at Cage Warriors 60. And Paddy then went on an absolute tear and became the Cage Warriors featherweight champion. Look, against Julian Arosa, a lot of people, including myself, felt he lost the fight. I wasn't being critical of that, as in saying, Paddy's shit, he's overhyped. That's not the case. This guy is 22 years of age. Give him a chance. This could be the secret ingredient as well for him to move on. But the shit he's getting with fans and overhyped, it always happens. It happens when Nate beat Conor. We've talked about it. Paddy Pimpett is 22 years of age. He will be back.
One thing before we move on. I love the way you went into that. It sounded like you're going to give the talk to your son. He goes, sometimes a guy loses.
Yeah. you know, I am a dad. Yeah. Big performance and a coming out party, really, in so many ways, was Nathaniel Wood beating Von Lee.
Looked phenomenal against, you know, Von Lee. He's a quite a good fighter, but a decent name, especially, you know, he's been with the UFC quite a bit and coming out. And that was a big, big performance. A great win. His work to the body, his combinations, beautiful. Very, very good fight and amazing performance. And I'm looking forward to seeing what Nathaniel Wood has coming up next, because I think he can be a star. I think that was a kind of a star-making performance. I think a lot of people are going to be keeping their eye on him.
Nathaniel Wood, obviously, you could see in the corner as well, was Brad Pickett. He's coming out of the same team as Brad. The prospect, as he said, you can't be called a prospect and not beat these guys.
Yeah.
He looked great. Obviously, his last defeat was against Alan Philpott, a regular on the show here with us at Bama 24. So it was a good return. He beat Chase Morton at Bellator 158 in London, and now Von Lee, he's back on track, and I'm looking forward to seeing Nathaniel fight again. He did say that Graham Boylan in the cage basically said title shot June, so that looks to be going ahead. Just looking further down the card, notables was Lloyd Manning lost a split decision to Paul McBain, and what a lot of people thought was the wrong decision. I want to go back and watch the fight in full detail. I just sort of watched it in bits and bobs as it was on. I wasn't paying that much attention as much as I was trying to see the TV. But yeah, Lloyd is an absolute, you know, we've had Lloyd on before, so it sounds like we're being biased in a way saying it. Yeah, we are, he's Irish. But I want to watch the fight back and sort of see it and see, was it a bad decision?
It was, I wouldn't say it was a bad decision. I'd say it was a very close fight. I scored to Lloyd. But it wasn't one of them fights where I'm like, oh, that's crazy, that's a terrible decision. Yeah. There was a couple of close rounds in there. I scored him to Lloyd. I thought he'd done the better work. But yeah, it was a close fight, and I definitely think Lloyd should have got the win. Don't think it was the worst performance, decision I've ever seen in my life, but it was, thought it should have went the other way.
Sticking with the Irish team, unfortunately, defeat for Keen Arrott in the second round of his fight against Sean Kenny. A big KO, TKO in the fight as well.
Nowhere as well, that it was like a big knee. And
yeah,
it was a good fight though. It was, you know,
So again, the Cage Warriors, if you're not on Fight Pass, get on Fight Pass. The fights are there, the main card is there. There was some good fights. Big show for Cage Warriors. Six or 7,000 people at the show.
Yeah, I just kept plugging. It's a packed arena.
Well, it was a packed arena, in fairness.
Yeah, well done.
But yeah, some good fights, some good notable finishes there as well. Lee Chadwick with a standing guillotine in the first round against Tommy Quinn was a great finish as well. So check it out. Yeah, some great fights. Like I said, the main card is on Fight Pass. Bellator 175 also went down on Saturday night. And as you know from listening to the full show, we did have Steve Thunder Beast Kozola, who got the win in devastating fashion as
excellent
well over Jake Roberts.
Yeah.
That was a notable standout as well. Sergey Karadonov, getting better at this, probably said it completely wrong. First round win as well was a big standout as well. But the big notable win as well on the night was King Mo getting defeat over Quinton Rampage Jackson, and obviously getting the nod to get Ryan Bader in New York. Anything else stand out for you on that card? Anything jump to your mind?
I don't have it in front of me. But yeah, those are the kind of main fights that stood out to me. What was the co-main event on that card?
They have the card all over the place as you look at it here.
But yeah, I thought good performance by King Mo. Rampage looked completely out of shape. Didn't look like he came in at, you know,
256,
which is that was with Jane, so just say, you know, give him 3 or 4 pounds. But he didn't look good. Looked really slow. You know, it was similar to the first fight in a way where, you know, Rampage kind of landed at times but just didn't do enough. But it was, yeah, it was a good performance by Mo though, and it's he'll really appreciate that win because that's a win that he really wanted. So yeah, well done, King Mo.
It was again Bellator, man. I'm telling you,
they're coming up.
Great fights there. So we want to thank our guests today. We've a list, Rob.
Yeah.
Darren Russell, thank you very much for coming on from MMA Latest and the Odds Bible as well. Danny Henry, the EFC featherweight champion, looking to get on the UFC. Thank you for taking the time to come on. Steve Thunder Beast, great name. Yeah. I love it, saying it. Kozola coming on as well after a great victory as well. Please talk about the finish rather than the Dillon Danis thing. Obviously, yes, that's the hype to talk. Everybody loves that.
Yeah.
But watch it after you watch his performance.
Yeah.
That's the best way of saying it. Amazing finish, boy. Yeah. Johnny Jitsu was Johnny on Jitsu. With us as well. Oh, thanks, Johnny, as always, getting on. He's
thanks for showing us your laundry basket.
The dirty laundry basket. We'd like to thank MMAMix.com because they're obviously good.
Because they're obviously fight top.
And, of course, Fight Store Ireland, the fighter's choice. Check them out. And, honestly, everything you need under one roof. They are currently having a sale on all Onnit product with Shroom Tech and stuff because it's been
I need my brain stimulated.
You gotta buy it soon because you won't be able to get it in Ireland and
why
soon.
Is it legal now, is it? What's saying. Going on?
It's something you can't, I don't know, it's something
but that doesn't give me confidence. I don't wanna have it if it's gonna be illegal.
So you're not helping sell the thing here. No, there's oh, big no, sale
get
on.
It. It's grand. It's
yeah,
good.
So, no,
I've had it before, it's perfectly good, fine for you.
But yeah, you know yourself. Check them out. Everything, honestly, the gloves, the equipment they have. I was blown away by it out in the store. Drop out of them. They're in the KCR.
I think I bought them in Fight Store a couple of years ago.
They're in the KCR out in the Crumlin neck of the woods. If you want to drop in or check them out online, the great stuff. Rob, thank you.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure.
Yeah, not for me.
So Rob's got to go home and edit all this now while I go home.
I will say one thing. It hasn't been done yet, but we are in the progress of moving audio. It shouldn't affect anybody. If you listen on audio right now, it shouldn't affect you. But if you notice next week you don't see a new show, search obviously Fight Talk on wherever you listen to the show, and there might be another kind of show popping up. It just depends what way it works out. We haven't sorted out yet, but it'd be quicker downloads, all that jazz. Be better.
Perfect. And do your usual. Follow us on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Obviously, Fight Talk at @talk_fight on the Twitter machine. Get sharing it. This is what gets us out there. We're only little, but we're getting bigger. This has been obviously Fight Talk 61. Peace.